Hey everybody, Josh Bentley, SAP Developer Advocate. Today I wanted to highlight a lot of news items for you around SAP Kima. We are upgrading the business technology platform to the newest Kima release 2.0. As Marco Dorn points out in this blog post, Kima 2.0 open source has been available for several months publicly, but now we are adding it to the SAP BTP runtime. During the upcoming maintenance windows in March 2022, you will see that we are rolling out 2.0 in the background. There will be no impact to existing workloads that existed before 2.0, but there are some things that are API related that Marco points out you may want to take special note of in this blog post. As for other upgraded features to look for, well, Marco lists out 10 different areas that he thinks we need to highlight. There's several blog posts linked from these and lots of information underneath each topic area. But if you're not seeing something in one of the topic areas that Marco lists, feel free to submit a question to the SAP community. Marco has also included a link to that as well. Kima 2.0 also has some very specific items that I wanted to highlight for you that I can do by taking a look at some very specific blog posts from some colleagues. First up is Jamie Cawley. Jamie has written about how the SAP Cloud Connector and the Kima control plane work. There are configuration details linked from Jamie's blog post that will help ensure your connectivity proxy is set up correctly. Jamie also highlights the SAP Kima BTP Runtime topic page, where you can keep up to date on all things Kima in one spot. Next, let's look at some blog posts from Gaurav Abhi. First, when you want to access data in an SAP system and update the state of that data, we have improvements within Kima 2.0 for how you would do that. Gaurav explains how it used to be done with service bindings, and now you can simply add the central gateway URL to your business logic. This really is a great improvement, and for those using APIs in Kima, we hope you can enjoy the more predictable and simple connectivity. Next up from Gaurav is another blog post that talks about giving you access to the underlying Kubernetes cluster. This is especially important when you are working with stateful applications and need access to the operators involved. And the last blog post I wanted to highlight from Gaurav, it's about eventing, which is a very popular feature in SAP Kima. The major change here is that we have simplified the way you use eventing without having to bind the application to a namespace, and you don't need a service instance created in the catalog. Lastly, I wanted to show another blog post from Marco Dorn that highlights how you can create your Kima instance via the command line. If you are a fan of the BTP CLI, we'll simply use Marco's guide to see what the steps are and also to confirm how to do this depending on what version and service plan you have that you're subscribed to for the SAP BTP system. So to recap, Kima 2.0 is being rolled out to production, trial, and free tier systems in upcoming maintenance windows. Lots of blog posts have been published, and more will be written to help you understand these feature changes and how to implement them in your Kima system. And finally, we have a place in the SAP community where you can ask any questions that you have and submit other ideas around SAP Kima.
Hey folks, Rich Heilman here, Developer Advocate, SAP Devs. So this week, I just want to make you aware of an ABAP coding challenge, which was created by one of our community members, Stefan Schmacher. Stefan has posted a blog post giving the details and the background story to go along with it. This is a debugging challenge wrapped in a mystery thriller theme. All you need to do is copy the code to your ABAP system and make it run. There are 24 or so errors in the code. Some are syntax errors, which you will need to take care of first in order to activate it. And then there are some errors which cause short dumps that need to be addressed as well. And then finally, there are a few that, although will allow the program to run, they will not allow the output to render correctly. I've gone through this challenge myself, and I have to say it was a lot of fun. So take a break from your daily work and challenge yourself with this debugging challenge from Stefan.
The community-driven unconference on the SAP Cloud Application Programming Model, CAP, is back. Recap 2022 will happen on Wednesday, June 1st and Thursday, June 2nd. Best thing is, it is now hybrid, both on-site and online. As usual, few slides, but a lot of hands-on and live coding. Less talk, more code. Follow Recap's Twitter account to stay up to date on the event.
Hi everyone, we have great news for you. UF5Con is scheduled for July 7th and 8th. This is the event for UF5 rookies as well as experts to connect and meet the UF5 community. It's going to be a virtual event open for anyone who's interested in UF5 and Fiori development in general. And the call for papers is open, so if you want to present or have other ideas for the event, such as games or networking activities, or if you want to help out in the background, check out Margaret's blog post and reach out to the team. And I'll see you there.
Version 1.0 of the SAP Cloud SDK was released back in 2017, bringing about a clean and convenient way to build cloud-native applications in Java on the SAP Business Technology Platform. Since then, over the years, we've seen fixes and new features with versions 2.0 and 3.0. Now, work is already underway to bring about the next major version of the SDK, 4.0, with improvements in four main areas. Easier dependency management. The aim is to reduce the transitive dependency footprint, which should in turn lower the risk of conflicts when the SDK is used in conjunction with other frameworks, such as the SAP Cloud Application Programming Model. There are new OData V2 features planned. Now, while the list of OData V4 services is ever growing, there's still, of course, a need to consume OData V2 resources, and version 4.0 of the SDK will see additional features such as the ability to access all data from batch operations and also to perform operations directly on nested entities. There are also improvements planned for the Destinations API to make it clearer and simpler to use. And last but not least, the thread context object and thread handling in general is also undergoing a series of improvements to bring better out-of-the-box support for some use cases. Read more about these improvements in the blog post from Matthias Kuhr.